55 and 72, and into some local road.
Okay, so you're close to this beautiful forest, right? Shawnee, is it?
I'm close to Louis area.
San Luis area, okay. Professor Chi she's a professor at the Southern Illinois University at Edwardsville, and she graduated from Louisiana State University, and she got her master's in applied statistics, PhD in transportation engineering. And she started working as an assistant professor at Montana Tech, and she moved to Southern Illinois University at Edwardsville, and then she's been there for the last 5 years. And today her talk is about comparison of contributing factors. It's a little bit different in here than in there, so I will read from there.
Oh, okay.
Comparison of contributing factors to pedestrian crossing crash severity at locations with different controls in Illinois. It's about safety and transportation. And without further ado, I'll let Dr. Chi start her presentation.
Thank you for the introduction. It really is my great pleasure to be here to present our recent research result. This research is funded by ICT and IDOT. We just finished the report last August. And this one, we have this present at TRB this January, and also we give a webinar this late January for the Rural Safety Institute. So here I will just condense one part of our project to discuss these safety issues here with our audience here. And I will try to finish in 40 minutes. So, but I don't mind if you ask questions, stop me if you have questions. So don't have to wait till last. So the title for this presentation is Comparison of the Contributing Factors to Pedestrian Crossing Crash Severity at a different location with like a different control types. First, I will give some background information of this research. And then I will talk about the data we used for the study, followed by the methodologies. And then it's the result and discussion. Of course, last one will be the conclusions. So why we all do this research? We all know the pedestrians are the most vulnerable users compared to all the other users. I will just show you some data. This is a safety issue of pedestrians. It's really a national and a global issue. So here I just want to give you some brief like a review, like some big picture. So this is the pedestrian fatality in traffic crashes in US. From 2005 to 2014. You can see over the 10 years period, the total fatalities occurred on the US road network. They have a trend of decrease, right? Except for this year, right? We only have like one pop out in 2012. And beside that, we have the trend of decreasing of the fatalities. But if you look at the pedestrian fatalities, you will see the fatality of pedestrians dropped from 2005 to 2009. But after 2010, they kind of bounced back to increase from here to here. Right? And from 2010 to 2014, it keep increase. And also, the percentage of the pedestrian fatality among the total traffic fatality also increases over time. So from 10 to 14, you can steady increase from 13%, 14%, and 15%. So that means it's really an issue we have to address. That's why many agencies have really emphasized those pedestrian safety in their safety plan. And talk about the pedestrian safety, we have to consider also different type of control. I believe you all the pedestrians, you walk around the area, you will notice that what type of control you have. You can cross the intersection with signal control, right, signal light. And you can walk across the intersections with stop or yellow sign. So those sides are all we call control side. But there's also another side we call it no control, like some middle block crossing. So along the road, you have a crosswalk, and no stop sign and no traffic light. So that's a crosswalk. At that location, we call it uncontrolled. So compare those three different types of controls. And I want you to really focus on those like numbers I highlighted here. So this is the Illinois number. From 2010 to 2014, so the total pedestrian crash is 24 something, the total. And it's split into different locations, uncontrolled, signalized, and the stop or yield sign control. You can see the split. So 56% of these pedestrian crashes occurred at uncontrolled locations, like mid-block locations. So that's the majority of them. And also, I want you to look at the fatalities. So among those pedestrian crashes, we have 673 fatalities. And those fatalities, 65% occurred at uncontrolled locations. So that's even higher percentage than the total number of crashes. So what this means? That means at uncontrolled locations, the severity level of the crash is higher, it's more severe. You will expect more fatalities at its uncontrolled location. So that's why we have to really understand what's really the characteristics really affect those. Different control types will affect those pedestrian safety. And also, I want to show you another data summaries. This is the one we present at the Rural Road Safety webinar. This is also like interesting finding. So we all know for the Illinois or any other state or area, we can divide the land use to urban and the rural setting, right? And look at the urban and rural setting. So we split data into rural, like rural crashes, right, and urban crashes. And just to focus on the severe injury. So this severe injury is including the fatalities and A injuries. Look at the percentage here. So that means more severe crashes occurred at the rural area compared to urban area. I want you to think about this question. So later on, we'll talk about that. And think about why we will expect more severe crash at the rural area. Because we all know, in urban area, you expect more pedestrian, more foot traffic, right? In like Chicago area, you will see more people walking around than atmosphere, okay? But why we expect more fatalities or injuries in the rural area? So that's a question for you. So because the control type really affects the severity level, so we need to really look into that. But the past studies, we all know the pedestrian safety is a topic, right? For research, it's a very hot topic. And many researchers have done to examine what's the contributing factors to pedestrian like crashes. And a lot of factors have been identified, like the gender, okay, and the age, okay, the lighting conditions, right, the weather, surface conditions. All those factors are identified will be related to the pedestrian crashes. But very limited studies have been done to really examine different control type on their severity levels. So to fill this gap, this research aims to investigate and compare various contributing factors to pedestrian crossing crash severities at the three types of controls: uncontrolled, stop sign or yield sign controlled, and signalized controlled location. The data we use is from Illinois. Okay, so that's the objectives. So now we know what we're going to do. So the data we use, of course, is the crash data, right? And the crash data is we obtained from IDOT. You may know or you may not know. The IDOT, they keep all the crash data in three separate data sets. They call the crash data and the person data and the vehicle data. So every time there's a crash, and they will collect all the data and then separate them into three different data sets. for the crash data, what we have here will be a location of the crash, where the crash occurred, and time, like a month, day, and really when, okay? And what's the level? Anyone get killed? So that will be categorized as a fatality. Someone get injured, so that's like A or B or C injured. And also, what is the geometric condition of the roadway? Like, is a two-way or one-way or two lanes each direction or three lanes? Do we have a median or non-median? So those kind of conditions. Also the weather. So it's clear or it's like a raining or it's snow. Those like weather conditions and also lighting. Do we have a light on street or not? And of course, we have the control device as one category. So do they have a signal or do they have a stop sign or yield sign or not? So and also they have some primary cause for this crash. The police usually will go there and kind of investigate, like interview everyone involved and then get some primary cause. But those primary cause are not, sometimes are not exactly the cause, but some primary cause, they just put it on site. So that's the crash data set. The personal data, they have all the data for the anyone involved in the crash. Involve the pedestrians and also the drivers. So their gender, age, physical condition, if they like drive under influence, like they drunk or they have drugs, use drugs, or what are the movement or the action they're doing at the crash time. If they make a turn or they want to cross the street, so what kind of action they are doing at the crash time. And if they have like a, if the visibility of the pedestrian is good or bad, so those kind of data. Another data set will be the vehicle data. So any vehicle involved in the crash will be put in this data set. For example, the type of the vehicle, any defect, the manufacturer, the speed, or what's the maneuver of the vehicle at the crash time. So that's the three data set IDOT maintain for their data like database. And beyond that, each crash will have unique number, two numbers actually. One is Illinois crash number, it's called ICN, and the other one is called crash number, crash ID. So these numbers are unique for each crash. So every crash, they will have their own number. So we can use this number to link the crash at the three different data set. So what do we have? So when we do the research, the IDOT give us all the crash data from 10 to 14. So, but we only interested in the pedestrian crashes. So the first thing we do, we want to extract the pedestrian crashes from overall the whole like data set. To do that, we use one item here. They have a collision type code within the data set. So when the code is equal to one, that means this is a pedestrian involved the crash. So by selecting all the data with this collision type equal to one, so we know this will be all the crash involved pedestrians. So then we collect all those from the crash data set, okay? And then we use this ID number, as I said in the last slide. So we have those identified like ID number. And we use this ID number to link this crash data with other person data and the vehicle data. So we know what part of this person data and the vehicle data will be pedestrian crash involved. And the last, we use this number to link all of them and form a big comprehensive database. This database will be only contains pedestrian involved crashes. And it has like a pedestrian crash data, vehicle data, and the person data. So that's how we get the data set that we want to use for the research. And after that, we know for this research, we study the impact of different controls on the severity levels. So we have to really categorize all this data by their type of locations, right? So, and also for the data set, they have a column item that the control type. So based on that, we categorize this, this data set with three like sub data set. So one will be uncontrolled. So that means no traffic light and no stop or yield sign. So we mark them with no uncontrolled. And another set will be stop or yield sign controlled. And the last set will be signal controlled. So that's the three categories we summarize based on the location with the control type. And here, for the uncontrolled locations, we explain that it's locations without traffic signals or yield stop signs. We can see the middle block locations definitely is uncontrolled location, right? Along the road, then there's a crossing walk. So that we call uncontrolled location. Another type of uncontrolled location will be for the two-way stop sign controlled intersection. So two-way intersection, two-way stop sign control, they only have a stop sign on the minor road, right? On the major road, there's no control at all. So that's also, that's two approach. So also we call it uncontrolled location. So that's the two type locations we consider in this research. And since we study the control type impact on the crash severity, so we want to look into the severity levels. And I think you are very familiar with this CAPCO scales. So all the DOTs in US use the CAPCO scales. Even how they define the CAPCO scales are slightly different from state to state, but they are pretty similar. So IDOT also uses CAPCO scale. So K injury means like a fatality. So if someone get killed, so in a crash, so this will be labeled as a K severity level. And the A injury is called incapacitating injury. So someone get like disabled after this like crash. And the B will be like lower level, so non-capacitated injury. And the C will be possible injury or no injury, cannot tell. And the O, this will be the last one, it's only property damage only. So still, IDOT use this CAPCO skills. So to describe the level of severity from the highest to lowest. And given those crash severity skills, and also this one is also in this data set. So each crash will have that skills, okay? A, B, C, K, or O. So this line shows the percentage of this pedestrian crash for different types, locations. And based on the severity level, key fatalities to damage only. And I want you to look at this fatality column here, bar. And also, we split them into three different controls. That's blue one is no control, and the orange one is the signal control, and the gray one is no control, or stop sign or yield control. So what you can see, and overall, you can see what's the trend you can find. Overall, for this uncontrolled location, for every level, for every severity level, key A, B, C, O, uncontrolled are always the majority, right? Always the majority of them, and especially for the like fatalities and A injuries, right? For the fatality and A injuries, the not uncontrolled locations contribute like more than half. So this one, that is 64%, more than 64%. Okay. And for the A injuries, like 56 like a percent. So that means among all these like severe injuries, most of them occurred at uncontrolled locations. So they do have some different characteristics we have to look into to figure out what's the reason and what we can do to improve the pedestrian safety, especially at uncontrolled locations. So this is like the overall like percentage. And this one just shows the percentage, didn't give you really how many numbers, like how many are key, how many are A and B and C and O. But look at it in the data. We have very unbalanced numbers. Like overall, we have 24,000 crashes total, but only have 600 something fatality, right? And also the last one, also the PDO only, property only crashes are also very small number. So that means most of the crashes are like a B or A or C. So this is we call it very unbalanced data. So if we use this unbalanced data to do the statistic analysis, that may cause some erroneous or some invalid result. Some model wouldn't like that. So to address this issue, we bin the like crash severity like skills into three new categories. So it's called severe injuries and non-injuries, minor injuries and non-injuries. What do we do? Let's see if I have another. Okay. So what do we do? We bin the data. We bin the fatalities and A injury into a new category. We call it the severe injuries to balance them. And the B injury just as themselves as a minor injury. And for the C, the possible or no injuries and the PDO were bin together as no injuries. So that's our three new threat levels instead of the CAPCO. In this way, we can balance the data. So in each category, the number of the crashes will be kind of similar. It's balanced. So to do the static analysis will be have no issue. So that's what we do before we go into the analysis part. And this is just I'll show you like the big table to show what's the distribution of the crashes for severe crashes, minor crashes, and no injury crashes along these three type of controls. And also you can see there are so many variables we consider in a study. So time, day of week, a season, crash hour, and the pedestrian age, pedestrian gender. So these are the time variables. These are the personal variables, pedestrian drivers in this table. And each like a variable have different levels. Of course, all of them are categorical data. So for day of week, so weekdays and weekend, season, spring, summer, winter, and fall. So those are the different levels for this categorical data. And look, just look at this data. I know it's kind of a little busy. Just look at data, what you can find here. What's the trend that you notice that? So this is, we focus on a severe like injury, like a fatalities and A injuries. And all like the non-controlled locations have like most of these A injuries, right? A and fatality injuries. This is all high. And for the minor injuries and no injuries, it still we have the same trend, but the number is kind of lower down a little bit. Still for the non-injury crashes, still we have that. So this is for the time variables and the person variables, and also we have some other variable, road surface variable and the weather conditions and the land use, all those variables. Again, those variables are just all like categorical data. And you will see the same trend. So for the non-control locations, we will account for most of the crashes. And the number is high and low, but it's still the majority of them, right? See from this table, just to show the data, okay, just directly show the data percentage, we can see for different like control type and for different level of severities, the number, the percentage are like not like equal, right? Not equal. So that means the influence of those controls on these severity levels are different. We all know from the table, we all know it's different. But we don't know if the difference are really significant or not. So that's why, and we want to run some statistical analysis to see if those differences are really significant, and which variable, which factors will be significantly impact those severity levels. So we can only do this from the statistical analysis, cannot just do from this like a percentage like a data. So that's the two purposes we want to run the statistical analysis, to identify the contributing factors impact the crash severities along the three type of locations. And also, we know it's a difference, right? We also want to know if the difference is significant or not. So that's the two purposes we want to run the test. So what type of analysis we will do? Because we will see from this data, we will see the severity level, like a severe crash, like a minor crash, and no crash, no injury crash. It's all just some categorical data, right? It's not really some like a real number data, like 1, 2, 3, 4. And also for the extreme variables, like a day of time, a season, an age, it's also some categorical data. So definitely the suitable like a model to do the analysis will be some categorical model analysis method. And because for the outcome, we have like a no injury, minor injury, and severe injury, so it's more than two levels. So here, we use the multinomial logic model, so MNL, because this have a more than two outcome. So if only have a two outcome, we do the regular logic model. But if more than two outcomes, we do the multinomial logic model. So the way they do it will be, they assume the probability to have outcome one and two, the ratio of them will follow this model. It will be equal to the e raised to power of this linear equation. So then we can calculate the probability for outcome 1, 2, 3, 4 and to k based on this equation. Okay, so this is the general equation for the multinomial logic model. So here, the y will be the possible outcome we call dependent variable. In our case, we use the three level of severities. Severity level, severity injuries, minor injuries, and non-injuries, so three of them. And the x will be the independent variable, it's called explanatory variable. So those will be the all this data, like raw surface condition, weather condition, time variables, all of this. And the key will be the possible outcome. So in our case, the key will be three. So severe, minor, and no. And the beta will be something we will fit from the model analysis. It will be the coefficient for the regression model. Okay, and this is the general format of this multinomial logic model. And I just explained, yes. So the dependent variables and the independent variables, and the way we test the effective of each independent variable is using the coefficient. So we have the coefficient get from the model. So we test if they are significant, and if they have the number, what's the like a meaning for that? If it's a positive, it's negative, what's the different meaning for that? And you all know for the multinomial logic model, they don't give you the probability directly. So here we see we can do the probability for severe level is how much, and the probability for minor level. But actually, if you run the model, they wouldn't give you directly the probability. What they will do, they will just compare. They have a base level, so they will choose one category as a base level, like a baseline, and they compare the probability of other outcomes with the base level. So that's the way they do. So they do a bunch of binomial logic model to compare different pairs. So that's what they do for the multinomial logic model. So in our case, which like a category will be the baseline? We choose the non-injury one, that's the baseline. So the severe injury level will be compared to the non-injury, and the minor injury level will be compared to non-injury level. So that's what the model will do. Also, I told you, for the all the independent variables in our study, all these variables here. So all these variables here, road surface, lighting condition, and day of time. So all these variables are also categorical data, right? So they are not real like numbers. So to code this data in the analysis, we cannot just import like a day of time, like a evening, morning, in the like a computer. So to really code them, we still code them as categorical data, like a 1, 2, 3, A, B, C, D. But still, we have to have a baseline too, a reference category, like we did for the severity level. So theoretically, which category you pick as a baseline doesn't really affect your result. So you can pick any one of them, the result will be the same. But for the purpose for easy interpret result, we pick the most or the least interested like a category. For example, we have a time like a night, evening, morning, and afternoon. The nighttime will be most interesting one. So we pick the nighttime will be the baseline. So every other time like intervals will be compared with the nighttime crash. Okay, so that's what we pick the baseline or reference line. Okay, and the software we used is SPSS. It's easy to use, right? You know, it's just a punk that click the buttons. Do not need to like write the code. And the SPSS report a lot of stuff. So we only look at the model coefficient and their standard errors. That's the one we really focused on. Because the we do the analysis, the focus is to really test which factor are most important, right? Not really to fit the model. So it's not really to look at the goodness of fit. So just to look at the significant level. So the p-values will be the one we use to examine the association between the factors and the outcome. And here we use two levels, significance, 99% and 95%. So p will be 0.01 for 99% confidence, and p will be 0.05 for 95% confidence. So I will show you the results then here. So that will be the result for the multinomial logic model analysis. So this is just a part of the table, so first part. So here, we have the variables we have for this table will be the time variables, like day of time, okay, season, and also the timing of the day, and also the like person variables, age, pedestrians, do they wear the contrasting clothes, and the driver age, okay, and the driver the physical condition. So this table shows the two big categories of variables. And how to interpret the table. So as I just said, we look at the betas. So beta 1 is the one corresponding to the compare of the severe level with a no injury, like those two ratios. And the beta 2 compares the minor injury with the no injury level. So that's the beta 1 and beta 2. And also we run the test like separately by uncontrolled locations and the stop yield sign control locations and the signal control locations separately. So we got this like the beta 1 and beta 2 for each different type of the controls. And how to really interpret the result. So look at the like the day of week, this like a variable. So the day of week, this variable. So now we have weekend. So that means we have weekday as a baseline. Now we have a weekend to compare with a weekday, right? And look at the uncontrolled locations. So here, beta 1 is 0.27. And they have a star here. That means it's significant at 95% confidence interval. So that means the chance to have a severe injury at the weekend, it will be higher because this number is like positive, will be higher than the chance at weekday. And the difference is significant because we have this like a like star mark. So that's what how we interpret that. So that means the chance of having a severe or fatality at uncontrolled locations will be higher on the weekend than the weekday. So that's how we interpret that. So know how to interpret the data and look at all the time variables, what we can see from here. So you all know like a weekend have more chance of the severe injury at uncontrolled locations, right? But for the stop sign and the yield sign control location, do you see that? There's no such trend, right? Because none of the numbers are significant. Okay. And we can see another one. The crash hour. So during the crash hour, you can have morning, afternoon, evening. So that means all these three time will be compared with night time, right? So look at the number here. For the severe level, all of them are negative numbers, and all of them are significant. So that means the night time are the highest, like at the time period, have the highest chance to have a severe like a crash at uncontrolled locations compared to morning, afternoon, and evening time. So that means what? Night time is really very dark time, right? Very dark. And when there's a pedestrian crossing at the mid block location, if they get hit by the vehicle, the chance they get killed or get an injury is much higher than evening time or morning time and afternoon time. So that's how we like interpret the result. And of course, you can see the same thing similarly to the stop sign controlled and signal controlled. They don't have many like stars, not many significant numbers. You only see this one that have a star, have a significant. That means less likely the people will get like injury or killed at afternoon time compared to night time. So that's how we interpret that. So another variable I want you to look at is will be the age group. So we have a pedestrian age, less than 14, like is like a child, and 25 to 64, that's kind of adults. And 64 and more will be kind of senior people. So those group are compared to which one? Compared to 14 to 25, right? To 14 to 25, that's our baseline group. So that's the youth group, right? So look at this number here. So none of them are significant, right? None of them have the mark. So there's no difference. Doesn't matter if it's a child or a young driver or it's an adult or senior. So they all have the same chance to get killed or get injured at uncontrolled locations. That means what? So at uncontrolled locations, all the groups of age groups are at the same level of risk. So doesn't matter if you are young people or small like kids or senior people, if you get hit by the vehicle, the chance to get killed or get injured will be the same, regardless of the age. So that's another finding. It's very interesting. So we did the same thing for the remaining ones, and we have so many of them. I'm not going to get each one of them. But I want you to look at this one, the land use, right? So that's the question I asked you at the beginning. So land use, we have the urban settings. So the urban setting will be compared with the rural setting, right? So here, you will see it's a negative 1.02 and it's significant, right? So, and also you can see all the numbers are negative and negative, right? Some of them are significant, some of them are not, but they're all negative. So that means what? So compared to the rural area, urban area have a less chance to get like fatalities or injuries or minor injuries. So that's the data shows. And why is that? So in the Chicago area, and compare Chicago area to Edwardsville, the where I lived in, you all know Chicago have more pedestrians going around on the street. But the fatalities and the injuries kind of less, the chance are less than those in the small, like rural town. Why is the reason for that? Can you think of some reason for that? Yes. Either way, yeah, either way.
Yeah, because in my question, because if it's in Chicago, you have more hospitals closer to attend and
oh, you said it can be saved later on.
Older,
oh. that's most of, yes. Yeah, that's a good point. And we can analyze this issue, and we discuss that. The major reason we think that will be, if you drive on Chicago and on the street, and all around you are like a pedestrian go around, so as a driver over there, you may like more prepared someone will be crossing, right? You expect that. You expect someone will cross, and you wouldn't just hit them. But in a rural area, just you drive on the road, and only one or two pedestrians walk on the street, you don't really expect them to cross. So you are not ready, you are not prepared for them, not expected. So that's why if someone just all of a sudden cross the road on a rural area, more likely you don't have really response time to really like reduce your speed or break your speed. And then you will have more severe injury. So that's the major reason. So this one will get some like a suggestion. That means When you deploy any treatment, you have to think about the land use, rural or urban, not just to think about the volume of the pedestrians. Sometimes the volume, have more volume, the pedestrian will be safer, right? So that's the one we like to discuss. Okay, I hope I'm not running too much time. So that's the major like findings we have and the result and to summarize that. So the conclusion we get from the analysis will be time of day and season are significant contributing factors to the fatalities and injuries at the uncontrolled locations, but have a very limited impact on the crashes on the control side. And the pedestrians are the most vulnerable users, regardless of the age. If you get hit, so the chance will be like killed or injured will be the same. And the females always like have like a cautious than males when they cross at uncontrolled locations. And wearing the contrasting like clothes, we have like highlight strip, will really help you to improve the safety. And aggressive driver behavior and DUI will be the major thing to contribute to the severe crashes, of course, this is expected. And the poor road conditions and the lighting conditions, adverse weather conditions, and the length and crossing distance will be all contributing factors to the severe level crashes at uncontrolled locations. And also the last one we just discussed, the urban area and the big cities with the higher population tend to have less fatalities compared to rural area with low populations. So that's the major findings, just to like summarize that. So that will conclude my presentation, and really thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, I will be more than happy to answer that. Thanks. Yes. I don't know if you have go over that. I think the on-campus one, yeah. If you go to the UIUC campus, they have a lot of crossing work, right? Market crosswalk. They have a market crosswalk, right?
Okay, so there is crosswalk.
Yes,
no
this
sign.
Crosswalk have no stop sign.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, have no signal.
Okay.
So that will be uncomfortable. But they do have the pedestrian crossing sign.
Okay.
You see that sign? The pedestrian crossing sign. But that sign is just a warning sign. It's not really a control sign. So you don't have to stop, like a stop sign. If a stop sign, you have to stop.
Okay.
If the line is red, you have to stop. But that pedestrian crossing sign, just a warning sign, just
okay.
Warning you the pedestrian may cross. So it's not really control like a levels of like.
Okay. So to follow up, for example, if a pedestrian is crossing the wall without no sign, like at a random place, and
mm-hmm.
there is a crash at that point,
mm-hmm.
do you label them as an uncontrolled location too?
You mean not on the crosswalk, just on the roadside?
Yeah, like somewhere random.
Do you
middle?
Yes, we will see that uncontrolled because we have the field review. We review like a lot of sites as like Peoria and Chicago and Champaign also. We see a lot of crashes occur at non-marked crosswalk location. So for example, there's a parking on the street, right? And there's a driver drive along at night. That's one, this is a sidewalk. Some of them just suddenly cross the street and they get killed. There's no marked crosswalk, but they get killed. So we say that's uncontrolled location too. This is the one reason we say the marked crosswalk is useful, is effective. Because if there's marked crosswalk, the driver may be like prepared somewhere will cross. So if there's no marked crosswalk, just go on sudden go cross, they may have a high chance to get killed or injured, like severe injuries. So
I thought the conclusion of the presentation was is to control the crosswalk or not. There is a crosswalk, but if you want to control or not. But if you include those data points that there is a crash without any sign, so that's going to kind of affect your decisions, right?
Okay, so where you put a crosswalk, that's something you have to make a decision on.
Yes.
So based on the need, if you have a need to go cross, doesn't matter what's the volume. So for example, you have this road, right? This is a neighborhood, and this is a convenience store. And we do have this issue, and we have eight injuries. Someone at midnight or 1 or 2 o'clock and get cross, buy some stuff from convenience store and get injured. So there's no marked crosswalk. So that means if there's a need for them to go cross, we have to provide some safety treatment for them to go cross. Not depend on the volume, not depend on how many people will use, just depend on the need. So even that the small community don't have like much like a foot traffic to go cross, but still we have to consider that.
Okay, so one more question. So about this
much normal.
So it is logistic regression, right?
The logistic regression will be, the basic one will be have two options, right? Have either A or B, right? Now we have three options. We can do severe injuries, minor injuries, and non-injuries. So we have three outcomes.
Even logistic regression, you can do multinomial logistic regression.
This is just the same category, just have more than two outcomes.
So my question is going to be, I couldn't see the accuracy of the regression, because you had kind of R squared or mid square error.
Oh.
Yeah.
This one is just regression. The beta 1, x1, this kind of vector, you can do be like beta 1, 2, 3, beta 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, and x1,
so,
x2.
So I couldn't see the accuracy, like you fit this equation to your data.
Yes.
You get some R square value or mean square error.
Yes, that's
so,
right.
So I couldn't see them, like can you comment on the accuracy of the models that you fit to?
Oh, as I explained, these are the beta we get from this result. And the reason we don't do the out of fit because we're not focused on fitting the model. We just want to test if the variable have impact on the different levels. We are not really fit the model. So that's the reason.
No, but if we have a low accuracy models, how we are gonna make sure the importance of the coefficients? For example, this
just look at the significant level. So as I told you here, we use a significance level. So whenever you have beta, we have outcome, they will show the p-value for them. So the p-value is less than 0.05, so it's significant. So we mark them. So that's how we test the impact of these variables on the different levels.
That's a nice presentation. I have two questions though.
Sure.
The first question is, when you were describing the probability damage only in pedestrian crashes, what does that mean?
Can you repeat the question?
So, the CAFCO system for predicting the crashes, you said one of the types of the crashes is just property damage for pedestrian crash. What does that mean?
You mean balance the data? What?
Before you balance the data, there were categories, five categories.
Yes,
the last category was just property damage.
Yes, the last one is the property damage only.
What does that mean?
So, nobody get injured, just lost some variable things.
have a crash with a pedestrian. Well,
like you have a luggage, and you pull luggage cross, and then someone just hit, and then maybe luggage was like a crash, and then you, yeah, the person is okay. So
okay.
That's called like a profit only damage.
And my other question is, how frequent this is reported, and for the IDOT information to be able to record this information?
How frequent or what?
This is recorded or reported.
This usually like you have a crash, you will call the police, right? And the police will have a report, and then the IDOT will have the report and also like store them in the like their database. I don't know if you have the safety class taken. So the IDOT have a report, like have a specific like format. So the front page and also reverse, and they have record like the model of vehicle, location and the possible cause, and the vehicle where the vehicle hit the pedestrian. And on the other side, they will draw a diagram to show the road side, what's the dimension of the road, and which direction the vehicle will move, and which direction the pedestrian will go. So and that's, they have a specific like a report, like format for them. Yes. Any other questions? I hope I explained well.
Any more questions? Maybe I have a question.
Yes.
Your initial table indicates the statistics about the pedestrian fatalities. Mm-hmm. So there's a rise in the pedestrian fatalities. Is that, I mean, what are the major, you know, driving reasons for increasing the pedestrian fatalities, other than just, you know, the control or uncontrolled? Are there other factors playing a role, in the rise of the fatalities after 2000, let's say 10 or 11?
I mean, the reason could be various. I most likely it's a human like error. Most likely will be human like factor. So would be, we have a pedestrian crossing sign, right? It's supposed to stop, to yell to the pedestrian, but it didn't. So the reason we want to study the factors will be, how can we improve the yielding rate? So if we have a sign, so that's not enough. We have to have a light, like a flash light to warn the driver. So most likely it's driver's fault.
Because what I'm also thinking is that, you know, I know in some campuses, you know, the use of cell phones are prohibited, because that the drivers are on the passenger pedestrian side. Could that be playing a role in increasing the fatalities?
That's true. Actually, this is a two-way, like two-part have responsibility.
Yeah.
So the driver have to see the pedestrian, they have to stop to yield. But also the pedestrian have their own possibility to not just like texting and crossing. They have to check the traffic before they step into the crosswalk mark. And you all know, the micro crosswalk, if the pedestrian get into the micro crosswalk, you have right away, right? You have right away, and the vehicle have to yield to you. But still you have responsible to check the vehicle before to step onto this marked crosswalk. That's one case, like one trial, like last year. So that's one pedestrian is in the cross mark, but hit by the vehicle. They bring to the court, and the judge ruled over in favor of the driver because of what? Because the pedestrian, they get into the crosswalk, they didn't check the vehicle. If the vehicle is too close to the crosswalk, there's no way for them to stop, right? So it's too close, you still got into the micro crosswalk. There's no way for the vehicle to stop. Still you have the responsibility. If you get hit, it's your responsibility. So you have to check before you step in. And even you have the right of way at the crosswalk, still you have responsibility to check the traffic before you step in. So that's we say two-way responsibility to make it happen.
Okay. No more questions.
Right.
I think we have time, yeah?
I may miss it, but when you compare the impact between like among like no control, stop sign control, or light control, do you only consider the absolute value of the number of accidents or crashes, or consider the ratio between the number of accidents over the number of the
stop sign? The way I did, I just we use the beta number, the beta coefficient. So for example, this beta may be significant for uncontrolled location, but this one is not significant for control location. So that's the difference we'll see. So that's how we compare the two.
How do you determine the beta?
This is running from the Scrum software. So we get the data, get input, and then the software will run the model and then get the output for the beta. Yes.
So my question is data out of topic, but I think it's important. So I'm curious who made the decision. mentioned that this intersection should be controlled, or it should just have a stop sign, or it should be lighted.
That's
so,
a good question.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, so are you familiar with MUTCD? Like a manual of the uniform the traffic control devices, MUTCD. They have all the warrants. So they have the warrants for stop sign, for traffic signals. They have 7 or 8 warrants. When you meet these warrants, you are justified to have a like light. So when you meet these warrants, you have a like a justified for a stop sign. So they have the warrants for that. But they don't have any warrant for the marked crosswalk. So that's why it's kind of gray area. That's why the IDOT sponsors this research to say have a guideline to guide their own like engineer to how to deploy those marked crosswalk in their like a, area.
Yeah, I heard from somebody that they said if there is a stop sign and 2 crashes happen, that they are changing to signal control. I don't know if it's true.
Yeah,
or not.
That's one warrant. So if the crash record shows, that's necessary to do that. If you already have a fatality, right? If you have fatality, just the stop sign is not enough to improve safety. So they will do improve that to another level. Guess the first. So that's another one.
This is the last question.
Yeah.
So, I have a question that is not it's one question.
Two interconnected questions.
If it jumps to the second question,
I like it.
No, it's just one question that is maybe not very related. It's related to the topic, but not exactly to the data that you presented.
Okay.
Now with the introduction of autonomous vehicle, and then I think past many days, there is an Uber vehicle that killed the pedestrian.
Yeah, yeah.
So how do you think that this new technology will be affecting all of the statistical analysis?
I believe that autonomous vehicle, like in Tampa, like through Uber, right, Uber autonomous vehicle just killed the pedestrian. What happened that it's in a dark condition, very dark. And we all believe the sensor of the autonomous vehicle really sense that object over there. But they fail to predict or to expect them to cross. That's why they fail to really predict the movement of the object. That's why there's no sign of like reducing the speed, no sign of brake of the vehicle, just like full speed. It's, I think 60 kilometer per hour is like 40 miles per hour. So just get the pedestrian killed. So this is really the kind of the error of the sensor itself. It is supposed to be, we all see the automobile vehicle is better than human being, right? Human being always make a mistake. We always want to have a sensor to help with this situation. So this specific situation, we want them to help. Because in that condition, just a regular driver, they can really hard to really sense or see any pedestrian over there. But with the sensor, it's supposed to see the pedestrian, see them to cross and then stop the vehicle. So that's really the car's issue.
But more than this, like at the end, if we are not looking at the conditions are good. But sometimes you have an accident, but then usually it's the human being who's taking the decision whether like if it's hitting a pedestrian or something. Now the machine is taking this ethical decision of whether to hit the pedestrian or to move and save 5 people that are in the car.
Now I ask you, do you think who is more reliable, people or the sensor? Who is more likely to make a mistake?
It's the human.
Okay.
I mean, it's the human also who takes the decision.
That's the thing. But we all know humans are more likely to make mistakes, so we won't have the machine or the sensor to help us. But also the sensors or machine are not really 100% reliable, right? So they still have some, maybe point, like 0.0001% unreliable moment. But at the moment, they kill the person, so that also happens. So this is some liability issue. That's why we have those automated vehicles. The technology are there, but they are not really legally kind of useful or very, very commonly used. So that's a liability issue.
Thank you.
Yeah, it looks like like safe topic. That's a topic.
Yeah, we can talk afterwards.
We like safety topics, right? My man, take a note on that, but that's something not safe. Let's thank Dr. G again.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, really.